Yeah, good afternoon, sir.
Yeah.
I am presenting 36 years old gentleman, Mr. Venkateshwarlu, resident of Guntur, farmer by occupation, who presented to our hospital with chief complaints of palpitations since last 2 years and shortness of breath since last 2 years. So the patient was apparently all
Sorry.
Right.
Murtuja, just give me the chief complaints.
Sir, those are palpitations since last 2 years and shortness of breath, exertional shortness of breath since last 2 months, sir.
Okay, fine. Okay.
He was apparently, yes, sir. Right, 2 years back when he noticed palpitation on exertion while working in the fields. It was insidious in the onset with gradual progression. The palpitations were rapid and regular, exertional. They were relieved by resting for over 20 minutes with no palpitations on resting. No history of post palpitation diuresis or syncope. He remained in the same functional stage for next 2 years with sudden aggravation of the symptoms on routine activities 2 months in last 2 months.
Murtuja, one thing.
Yes, sir.
When you talk about the palpitation, you have spoken perfectly. Except that post palpitation, no diuresis, and you are talking about syncope. Syncope should come along at the time of palpitation, not post syncope.
Okay, sir. Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Yes. Okay. Yes. Yeah.
And since the last 2 months, sir, his symptoms have aggravated, and even he is getting palpitations on routine activities. This is associated with heaviness in the left side of the chest.
Again, you are grading.
Sir, I couldn't get you, sir.
You are grading of the shortness of dyspnea on exertion.
Yeah. I'll tell, sir. I'm first elaborating the palpitations. And initially, it was stage 2 in that. Yeah. And since last 2 months, it has increased on even on routine activities which he is doing. So it has increased to NYHA class 3.
Okay, as far as palpitation is concerned. All right. Okay. Okay.
And this
but
is
NYHA
this
classification. By and large, you do not
for heart
use for do not use for palpitation. Okay.
Yeah, it's for heart failure and dyspnea.
Yeah, basically for heart failure and angina equivalent. Okay.
Okay. Sir.
Not angina. Angina equivalent.
Right.
Which is the classification for angina per se?
Canadian classification is there, sir.
That's right. That is the one which is only for angina. So that is accepted as angina. This is angina-like symptoms classification can be included into NYHA. All right, go ahead. Good.
So this palpitation is associated with heaviness in the left side of the chest since the last 2 months, which is mild and is only associated with palpitations. There is no radiation of this chest heaviness or not associated with any sweating, and it is relieved also with rest as with palpitations.
Yeah. Okay.
There is history of shortness of breath since last 2 months, which was sudden in onset while working in the fields and on lifting heavy weights, and it is progressing rapidly in the next 2 months to having shortness of breath even on routine household activities. Due to this, he had to restrict his household outdoor activities and is now homebound since last 15 days, sir.
Okay, very good.
No history of cough, diurnal or postural variation of this dyspnea. There is no history of orthopnea or history suggestive of PND.
Okay.
Along with this, there is no history of any giddiness, pre-syncope or syncope. No history of easy fatigability. There is no history of pedal edema, abdominal distension. No history of sore throat or fleeting joint pains in the initial years of life, ruling out history suggestive of acute rheumatic fever. And there is no history of any prolonged fever, hematuria, skin rashes, ruling out history suggestive of any infective endocarditis.
Okay. Murtuja?
Yes, sir.
Again, you have not mentioned the NYHA classification here. what was the NYHA classification? He started having shortness of breath two months back.
Yes,
and
sir.
What is his present NYHA classification? That is important, that he has landed up with this particular NYHA classification. Okay, that is one thing.
Yes, sir.
The second, this is very important that you mention about the NYHA classification. Okay?
Okay.
The second thing is associated, you talked about orthopnea and PND. Very well. Then the associated factors, as far as shortness of breath is concerned, you talk specifically of features suggestive or related to shortness of breath.
Okay. Okay.
What are they you're talking about? You don't talk about those things which are associated with. You cannot include these into the features of rheumatic fever and infective endocarditis into this. Okay?
Yes. Yes.
When you talk about associated features, you talk about this particular symptom also which you want to elaborate. You understand? Because
yes,
you are misleading us. You are misleading us. Yeah?
So, the negative history with dyspnea will be, there is no history of orthopnea or PND, sir.
Correct. Orthopnea and PND is one of the things. And any of the aggravating factors as far as this particular SOB is concerned.
Yes, sir. It is being aggravated by exertion.
Yes. That is exertion. We know that it is shortness of breath because of exertion. Any other features which are likely to aggravate the shortness of breath?
Any chest pain, associated chest pain along with it, sir?
That's right. One is the chest pain. Whether any chest pain associated with this, which is precipitating this shortness of breath. Anything else? Anybody?
Sir, the shortness of breath is also associated at the time when palpitation is occurring.
Correct.
Sir.
The second is palpitation. I'm talking about, as far as shortness of breath is concerned, what are the aggravating things which you should talk about and say that this is the negative history. For example, whether it is associated with chest pain, the other thing is associated with palpitation. Anything else?
Any associated fatigue or...
That's right. You know, such a sudden onset of fatigue abilities, which are associated with this particular shortness of breath, that patient becomes exceedingly exhausted, and associated fatigue ability is the thing. So these three factors you have to consider in a patient who are presenting with a history of shortness of breath.
Yes.
These are associated features which you are going to talk. Negative history or positive histories.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Now, this patient already has history of palpitation. So, it becomes, you have to talk about whether the palpitation is associated with shortness of breath, as well as the shortness of breath, whether it is precipitated by the palpitation. You understand? Because they are intermingled with each other. One can give rise to the other thing also. Okay.
Yes, sir.
And then when you talk about the other things, you say that there are no other features which are suggestive of acute rheumatic fever or suggestive of infective endocarditis. Okay, don't tie them up with the presentation of the history. Yeah?
Right.
Okay, very good. Very good presentation till then. Now, go ahead.
With regards to treatment history, he was seen by a local practitioner who prescribed him a medicine. He was prescribed a single medicine and... He says that this has increased his urine output, suggestive of some diuretics, sir, she was given.
Okay.
And he has been admitted.
You can say that he probably has got a diuretic which has increased his urine output on the basis of this thing. Yeah. Okay. Straight away you can see. You need not go around the bush. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah.
There is no past history of significance. No any significant history of significant medical or surgical illness like hypertension, diabetes, or any history of coronary artery disease. He has normal bladder and bowel habits, no addictions in the form of tobacco, drug abuse, or alcohol.
Mm-hmm.
He is on a mixed Indian diet, which is adequate in calorie and proteins. He is a member of a three-membered family, and there is no family history of any coronary artery disease, any hypercholesterolemia, or any significant illnesses. And the family belongs to a lower middle class according to modified Kopuswamy scale.
Okay. That is the history?
Yes, sir.
Okay, there are two questions I'll ask you.
Yes.
What are the features? You're coming from Hyderabad area, correct?
Yes, sir.
What are the features as far as the occupation is concerned, which are related to cardiovascular system. Occupational hazard manifesting for cardiovascular problems.
Sir, those persons who are working in, first of all, industries and all, they industrial areas, they will have maybe smoke and all will have like something like passive smoking effects.
Alright, lower down. When you talk about industrial hazard, which is the biggest problem which comes with them? Anybody, industrial hazard.
Sir, those are mostly with like those working in lead industries or those working in benzene and all hydrochlorocarbon industries. So fumes of those can produce problems, but they, that are not cardiovascular mainly.
Okay. Anything lead, yes, one of the important things can lead to issues related to the lungs and this thing. Anything issue related to lungs, any other
occupational
things?
Lung diseases.
Yes, what are they?
Silicosis.
And the manifestation may not be direct as far as cardiovascular system is concerned, but indirect is because of the development of the interstitial lung disease and manifesting with congestive heart failures. Okay, this is one of the associations of occupational hazards. Okay. As far as the region is concerned, from which region you are coming or wherever you are coming, as far as India is concerned, do you know what are the cardiovascular associations with region wise as far as CVS is concerned?
Like in the southern parts of our country, like in Kerala, sir, endomyocardial fibrosis is common. It was
EMF. Commonly very good. EMF is very high. Yes, very good. Yeah. Anything else?
Coronary artery diseases are more common in the northern parts of our country.
Little lower down.
In Punjab.
Lower down. Not so much to be taken up higher. Related basically to the area from which you are coming. Okay, I'll give you a hint. Besides EMF, which is the other one which is likely to have problems related to right heart problems only?
So the other problems can be ARVD or
Wolff's anomaly. ARVD is not. It is basically determined by the genetic things.
Yes.
Region-wise, then EMF, right, Kerala is one, absolutely right.
Cation's disease.
No.
Cation's disease, selenium deficiency.
No.
Sir, high altitude associated primary pulmonary hypertension. And
very good. PPH, primary pulmonary hypertension coming in high altitude, particularly in situations like Leh, Ladakh and other areas, PPH is common. The other focus of PPH comes in which area? Very important. It is in Kutch. Okay. Kutch area is one where the incidence of PPH is quite high. So you must remember these two things for PPH. One is coming into high altitudes, basically Leh, Ladakh areas, and the other is Kutch, which is manifesting in there. Okay. Any other?
Yes.
Sir, Central India, Satpura belt, hypothyroidism is very common. Sir, Central India, Satpura belt, where the hypothyroidism is very common. And
that is a medical problem, yes, can manifest with cardiovascular thing coming as hypothyroidism. Hypothyroidism is coming in those situations, Central India. What about other things? Thyroid, I just remember and skip my mind.
Okay, Himalayan region, sir.
We said about it. PPH, which is high altitude things, yeah. And coming as in Kerala and this thing and the central, yeah. Okay. Central India, yes. Which is the region where you get Kala Azar most?
Sir, Kalazar is most common in Bihar and Uttar Pradesh.
What is the cardiac manifestation?
Not sure, sir.
Sorry?
I'm not sure, sir.
Anybody? What is Kalazar?
Sir, leishmaniasis. Mr. Leishmaniasis, sir. Cardiac anomaly.
Yeah, leishmaniasis. What is it? What does it happen? What does affect? What is affected basically for Kalazar?
Sir, mainly the lymph. There is high-grade fever, splenomegaly is there, massive splenomegaly is there.
Yeah. And what are the associated things which you get with Kalazar? You're right.
Can have heart failure, Herman.
Heart
failure, pericardial effusion, sir. Pericardial effusion and heart failure.
That's right. They usually present with serous problems, you know, presenting as pericardial effusion or pleural effusion. And these people also have got incidences of thromboembolic phenomena occurring in them. Okay?
Okay, sir.
So these are certain areas which we predominantly look for, or if this is coming from that particular area, you have to think about these particular things. All right? Okay.
Right.
Now, Murtaza, coming to your family.
Yes, sir.
Family history. Correct?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Now, as far as the valvular heart, we are basically, I think we are harping mainly on a valvular heart disease possibly in this particular patient. So, we are talking about which are the familial incidences of valvular heart disease which runs in the family.
Sir, first of all, like acute rheumatic fever, which can lead to rheumatic.
No. That does not read into familial.
Okay. Sir, bicuspid aortic wall.
That's right. Yes. Bicuspid or aortic stenosis, bicuspid aortic wall. What is the incidence, male to female?
Sir, the incidence of male to female is 2 is to 1.
No, 4 is to 1.
4 is to 1. Okay.
4 is to 1 in male to female.
Okay.
Of aortic stenosis, bicuspid aortic wall. Okay.
Yes, sir.
As per Perloff. Okay, one is aortic stenosis. Then second one what? Familial. Come on.
Mitral wall prolapse.
Mitral wall prolapse is when you manifest as a part of the Marfan's or Marfanoid syndrome, which is there running into the family. Correct or not?
Yes.
Then you talk about it as a familial thing. That's right. But lower down, coarctation lower down, that is again manifest
yes.
as part of whether it is an exo syndrome coming in or not. Okay. I'll ask you that exo. Wait, that good you reminded me. Okay. Fine. Which other? Are hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, obstructive cardiomyopathies, no?
Yes, sir.
That should come higher up in card. The first thing which should come as a familial thing coming up is hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Then comes your aortic stenosis. Valvular aortic stenosis manifesting as bicuspid aortic valve. What about other things? We just talked about certain thing, no? PPH. PPH runs in the family, particularly if it is in the female side. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Familial incidence. Then you come to your Marfan's, then you come about coarctation, which can run into the families, particularly associated with chromosomal abnormalities. Okay, all this well. Understood?
Yes.
As far as familial transmission of non-cyanotic heart disease or heart disease are concerned, okay?
Yes, sir.
Valvular. All right? Okay.
Right.
Okay, good. Mustafa, go ahead.
So,
okay, you are talking about this, and now as far as the history is concerned,
yes,
we
sir.
Will try to come to whatever your consideration is, as right. far as the diagnosis is concerned.
Yes. Sir, this has been a history which is there in a, from last 2 years, and there is, like since last 2 months, there has been sudden deterioration. So I would like to consider those cases in which there is some acute on chronic, there is some acute insult on some chronic lesion, sir.
Alright, okay.
Like, okay. My first differential according to this history will be acute on chronic AR, which has led to LV dysfunction now, which can be due to either infective endocarditis, but we do not have any history suggestive infective endocarditis, or okay. AR.
Okay, Murtaja, yes, Murtaja, one sec. I'll interrupt you.
Yes.
One is you talk about non-cyanotic heart disease.
Okay.
Non-congenital heart disease.
Okay, sir.
Which manifests with palpitations first, because that is the first symptom coming in. Correct or not?
Yes, sir.
In your patient, that is the first symptom. So when somebody presents with palpitations, what are the things which will come to your mind? What are the things which will? I'm talking about non-congenital heart diseases. Okay.
Okay. Yes, sir. So the we should basically keep, if we are thinking of palpitations due to cardiac causes, sir, we should basically keep two things in mind. First, it can be due to arrhythmia.
We are limiting ourselves to cardiac only.
Okay, sir. So it can be due to arrhythmias, or it can be due to volume overload of the chambers of the heart, sir. With regards to volume overload of the chambers of the heart, as I said first, sir, like acute AR which has occurred on some chronic AR was there, and acute insult has occurred, and due to that, palpitations has increased, sir. And this
I will further interrupt you.
Yes,
you have given us a history of palpitation which is regular, which comes only on exertion, which relieves over a period of about 20 minutes when the patient is resting. Correct or not?
Yes.
So, in other words, this is not an electrical abnormality which is occurring in this patient. Correct or not?
Yes, sir.
It is not an SVT or a VT or whatever it may be. Okay?
Yes.
It is a regular one which is occurring because of exertion. Now you tell me, what are the ones which are coming with palpitation in an exertional fashion and having a valvular problem, non-congenital heart disease?
So, first of all, sir,
volume overload situations, correct? For example, AR or MR.
Yes, sir.
Either of them can present, because the volume is high, they will come with palpitation as a presenting feature, which may come on exertion and then relieve with rest. Correct or not? Coming regularly with exertion. Otherwise, it does not come. Right?
Yes, sir. Yes.
So, volume overloaded heart, either AR or MR. What other thing?
Other causes of volume overload can, like sinus of Valsalva rupture acute, can lead to volume overload and can produce...
Yes. Yes, very good. Yeah.
Then acute, sir, in the case of hypertrophic obstruction,
We are talking about palpitation which has progressed and continuing since the last 2 years. These are basically exertional palpitation. So in other words, it tells you that this is basically a palpitation which is occurring because of forceful contraction of the heart. Correct or not? As far as the palpitation is concerned. Now you link it with the shortness of breath which is coming since the last 2 months. Okay? What are the possibilities which are coming in the volume overload things? You talked about AR, you talked about MR, you talked about rupture sinus of Valsalva. Yeah? Rupture sinus of Valsalva.
It can be a case of dilated cardiomyopathy, sir.
Yeah.
Which has now presented.
Yes. DCM
also. HOCM which has deteriorated, sir.
All cardiomyopathies. Include all cardiomyopathies.
Yes,
okay? Coming into this particular picture.
Yes.
Now, presenting with shortness of breath, we will consider that little later on as a hypertrophic or congestive cardiomyopathy. Okay?
Sir, can we also put primary PH as a differential? Because if he is presenting with exertional pain and palpitations, primary PH...
Primary PPH, I would not consider that, because usually it is not a volume overload feature. Presenting feature in PPH is a syncope or near syncope which comes. So here, because the palpitation is an exertional palpitation, that means it is a volume overloaded heart. That is for sure. Enlarged heart, in other words. So we cannot consider that a history findings. Okay? Again, the shortness of breath. Then we would talk about effort intolerance rather than shortness of breath. Okay. Now, this patient who has got volume overload, we have thought about AR, MR, rupture sinus of Valsalva, or cardiomyopathies. Correct?
Yes.
Now presenting with shortness of breath in the last 2 months. Okay. Possibility of what? Either of these people, either of these differential diagnoses, who's going into decompensation, correct or not? Either any of them. Whatever may be the reason of decompensation, why do you say that it was chronic and then it is going into an acute phase? Is there a sudden onset of shortness of breath which occurred?
Yes, sir. There is a sudden onset since last 2 months, but he was having palpitation symptoms since last 2 years. So I am thinking more of acute insult on some chronic.
Did it start suddenly at 2 months back, or it was evident at 2 months and then it is gradually continuing? Or whether it is progressed significantly over the course of time?
Sir, in the last 2 months, there is a sudden deterioration in the form of like he cannot exert now, which he was doing his routine work. But now he is unable to do his routine works also. And this has also aggravated in last 15 days that he is like homebound. He can't even go out to work, sir.
Okay. So now the important factor which I think you missed out in this particular history is what has happened to his history of shortness of breath with or without treatment. Whether he was having any treatment or not is an important factor which you have to consider when you are telling. That's why I said, when you come to the history part, when your associated features you are talking about, no, one of the features which you have to consider, what happened to that with the treatment part, whether the patient got treatment and how did he manifest with that, with the treatment. You understand? Because it has got a very important implication.
Yes, sir.
So when you talk about the associated features, for example, chest pain, palpitation, fatigability, and treatment received, and what has been the outcome of the treatment for this particular patient, this is very important to tell you what has happened to the patient as far as treatment is concerned. Okay, so we talk about this patient who has gone into a left ventricular dysfunction, or I mean talking about a ventricular dysfunction in this patient, and is manifesting with this thing. So any one of them can be presenting with the LV dysfunction, isn't it? Either AR, either MR, rupture sinus of Alvarez, or cardiomyopathy. So these are the four diagnoses which we have in mind as far as the history is concerned. Once we go on to the clinical examination, we will be able to differentiate between all of these things. Okay? All right?
Yes. Okay. Sir, can we put congenitally corrected TGA with left AV valve regurgitation as a TD in this case?
You can always consider that as a possibility in this thing, provided you come to a diagnosis later on. But you cannot include that as far as the history is concerned. Okay? As I said, the history, if you are considering, then the analysis will come little later on into the physical findings and the thing. If you find discrepancy in the situs and the side of the heart, as I always tell you, okay? That is the first diagnosis which will come into your mind of corrected transposition. Okay? And then the presentation usually for such people who are presenting with congenital anomalies, the presentation is much earlier. Not at the age of 36 years of age. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Yeah.
Okay.
ASD in this? Yeah. ASD. Atrial septal defect. Yes, you can take it to the back of mind if you are talking about a congenital heart disease which is presenting. But usually shortness of breath is not a feature which comes with atrial septal defect. In such situation, basically, you can get palpitations because of the enlargement. They can get arrhythmias added on to the enlargement, but shortness of breath usually is not a presenting feature for these people. Okay, so it comes little lower down into the thing. We don't consider this as a present. And then usually they tend to have some history of repeated respiratory infections and things like that, because it is pulmonary plethora which is occurring in such patients.
Sir, I go ahead, sir. For examination.
Yeah, please. Yeah, go ahead.
On examination, he is a middle-aged male of average build and nutrition, conscious-oriented, and he is quite cooperative. Mm-hmm. His vitals are, the pulse rate is 80 per minute. It is regular, rhythmic. It is high volume and collapsing. Normal character of the vessel wall, there is no radioradial or radiofemoral delay. All the peripheral pulses are palpable. signs of peripheral runoff are present, sir. Like, first of all, in this case, Landolfi's sign was present, in which the pupils were dilating and constricting alternatively. There was lighthouse sign present in this. Water hammer pulse was present in this case, sir. Mm-hmm. Then Quinquius sign was present in the nail beds in this case. Mm-hmm. Durosier's murmur was present in this case, and in the dorsalis pedis was also easily palpable. That is, the Shamroth sign was present in this case, sir.
So all peripheral signs of runoff
were present, sir, very much evident.
Okay, all peripheral signs, okay.
Yes, sir. The blood pressure was 124/60 mm of mercury in the right arm with a pulse pressure of 64 mm of Hg. In the left arm, it was 120/58 with a pulse pressure of 72 mm of Hg. In the lower limbs, the systolic pressure was 148 on the right side, and on the left side, it was 146 mm of Hg, sir.
Okay.
So there is a wide pulse pressure, and there is a systolic, there is the difference between the upper limb and the lower limb systolic blood pressure is approximately 24 to 26 mm of Hg, sir. The respiratory rate was 18 per minute. It was abdominal thoracic regular. He was afebrile to touch with a temperature of 98 degrees centigrade. The saturation was 96% in all four limbs. He had a BMI of 17.5 kilogram per meter square, with a upper limb is to lower limb ratio of 0.8 and an arm span of 165 against a height of 167 centimeters. Some pallor was present. There was no icterus, cyanosis, clubbing.
Hello. Murtaja, before I go on to the other parts of it, I'll also come. When you talked about the height, did you talk about the arm span?
Yes, sir. I talked about height and arm span, sir.
What is the arm span?
Sir, height is 167 centimeters. The arm span is 155 centimeters. Arm span is 2 centimeters less than the height.
What is the ratio which is supposed to be diagnostic of Marfan's?
For diagnostic to be Marfan, at least the arm span should be more than 5 centimeters more than the height, sir.
Yeah, okay. That is one aspect and of it. What are the other criteria of diagnosing Marfan's on the basis of structure
from sir,
the skeletal? Yes.
First of all, he will have like wrist sign and thumb signs are there, sir.
Yeah, wrist sign, thumb sign, good. Very good.
Then they will have, he will have tall habitus, tall marfanoid habitus with long lips.
You tell us specific things which are diagnostic of Marfan's. You talked about the arm span, and you talked about wrist. You talked about the thumb. What about the other things?
In the eyes, there will be anterior dislocation of the lens, sir.
How will you see anterior dislocation of the thing? On clinical examination?
Not on clinical examination.
Then, right, then why? What is then, the clinical sign we'll get on the eyes? Come on, somebody has to tell me.
Tremulousness of the iris, iridotonus.
Sorry?
Iridodonesis.
The iridodonesis. The iris is twittering because the support of the lens is not there. You understand?
Yes.
On the clinical, on the light examination of the pupil, you can make out that whether besides the peripheral signs, you can make if the pupil is quivering. That is iridodonesis. If he is having, then it is suggestive that there is likely to be a subluxation of the lens. Okay?
Okay.
Alright. Then what are the things?
Sir, upper segment is to lower segment ratio is important, sir. In the case of Marfan's, the lower segment will be more, so the ratio will decrease.
Yes. So how much is the segment? You talked about the span.
Yes, sir.
And this thing. What about upper segment, lower segment?
Sir, it is 0.98 in my case. So it
now
is
what
like
is the normal, which is suggestive of Marfan's?
So
Marfan's is very commonly asked, everything in detail as far as exam is concerned.
So the ratio should be less than, sir,
is going to be there, everybody.
I'm not sure of the exact value, sir.
Anybody. Diagnostic of 0.8. That's right, 0.8.
It is the 0.8 is the ratio. All right?
Okay.
So thumb, I mean the high span more than the thing by 5.8 ratio, your wrist sign, your thumb sign, your subluxation, anything else?
Sir, high arch palate.
Yeah, very good. High arch palate, which is, well, okay, yeah, very good. Then you talk about,
chest wall and final deformity.
Correct, absolutely right. The spinal deformities are very common in Marfan's, particularly presenting with kyphoscoliosis and other problems, okay? So that is one of the features as far as skeletal abnormalities are concerned, okay? Now, if you go on to the other things, okay, you want to, as far as the skeletal parameters are concerned, if you want to be confirmatory, what is the one which will do for making diagnosis of Marfan's?
Sir, that the arm span is to height ratio, sir. Arm span.
No, forget height. That you are done. I am talking about you want to be diagnostic.
Marfan's,
you must know inside out.
Sir, a genetic mutation, fibrillary.
That is much in detail a common thing which you can ask. What X-ray are you going to take?
Metacarpal
mutation.
Arre, talk about metacarpal index, no? Where are you going to about other thing, genetic and this thing? What is the metacarpal index in Marfan's? Murtaja,
yes,
Marfan's, you must know inside out as far as DM exam is concerned. What is the, come on, somebody has to come out with metacarpal index. What do you do in metacarpal
index? 8.4, sir.
What is the metacarpal index?
So it is the average ratio of the length of the metacarpals of second, third and fourth. Average width of this four metacarpals.
Yes. What is the diagnostic thing? What is the magic figure? No, I am not going to tell you everything.
More than
8.4. I am not going to tell you everything. You should read and lend me next time. Now I am going to write down here and I am going to research with the metacarpal index. This is one of the diagnostic features of Marfan's. Okay? You don't go into genetic things into the...
Yes, sir.
So, Murtaja, you are going to tell me next time about the metacarpal index. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Now, before you go on to the other thing, I was talking something about the exo. Somebody had mentioned about exo as far as coarctation is concerned. Correct? So, I am just diverting a little bit. Coarctation of aorta. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Or otherwise, I think you will come later. Okay, I'll come to the peripheral signs now in this patient, Murtaja. You talked about his pulse pressure of about 60, 64 to be precise, in the right upper extremity. Then his right lower extremity pulse is only about 24 to 25, correct?
Yes, sir.
In a patient, you are talking about who's got a wide pulse pressure, right?
Yes, sir.
So you keep this in mind. You are talking about all the peripheral signs of aortic regurgitation. Correct?
Yeah.
Okay. These peripheral signs of aortic regurgitation usually come when there is a very, very wide pulse pressure. They do not come like this with a pulse pressure of just about 60 or so. When there is a significant discrepancy between 120 and 140 or 150 as far as the right lower extremity pulsation is concerned. So this is a discrepancy as far as your findings are concerned. All right?
Okay. Then
the other thing is when you are taking the pulse pressure or the blood pressure in a patient who has got aortic regurgitation. Okay. How do you determine what is the diastolic pressure in this particular patient?
So So actually, we won't, in if we are getting the, like if we are measuring with a sphygmomanometer, sir, there we will get in a, for diastole, we won't get a clear cutoff. So we will take the muffling of the sound which we are getting, because that will go, the sound will go up to zero, sir. So we will have to take the point of muffling, sir.
Correct. You will have to take the muffling of the Korotkov sound as the feature which is suggesting to you as the diastolic pressure in this particular patient, correct or not? Now, does your sounds go up to zero or below that 60 or not, or it ends only at 60?
Sir, it was going below 60 actually.
Then you have to mention. So you but have to mention
was there from, yes sir.
So okay. The feature in the blood pressure what you have to give is to give 120 by 60 by whatever it is. Okay?
Okay. Matlab, till when we can hear the sound, right?
Yes, yes. And then you elaborate that this is the muffling of the sounds and this is the disappearance of the sound. The disappearance does not correlate with the diastolic pressure. It is the muffling which manifests or comes with this thing, okay?
Yes.
So this is showing a tremendous error as far as your finding is concerned. Okay? But why I'm trying to emphasize is you're giving all peripheral signs of severe aortic regurgitation, and then you're showing us only
pulse pressure
going only about 60 or so. Okay?
Yes.
Alright? The second thing is your discrepancy between the upper extremity pulsation and the lower extremity pulsation, okay? In which setting of aortic regurgitation, in which setting of aortic regurgitation, severe aortic regurgitation, you will have such findings?
Like if there is AR with AS, sir, or acute AR.
Very good. If there is an associated aortic stenosis with, because that is one factor which you have to consider, because your systolic in the upper extremity also is normal, correct? In a wide pulse pressure with aortic regurgitation, usually the range is that the systolic increases, the diastolic goes down, and that is how it gives rise to wide pulse pressure. So here in your case, the systolic pressure also is decapitated, okay, at about 120. And that is why you might be finding that there is a discrepancy as far as the Hill sign is concerned.
Yes, sir.
Okay?
Yes, sir.
One
yes.
is aortic yes. stenosis associated. Very good. Second one.
Acute AR, sir. Acute AR won't have peripheral signs.
Usually acute AR, yes, if you do. But you will never have the peripheral signs of aortic regurgitation.
Yes,
here you cannot consider at all. Okay? But that's right. LV dysfunction if sets in a patient of aortic regurgitation, if significant LV dysfunction sets in, then the systolic is going to be decapitated. The diastolic may continue to be going down to zero or C, and the Hill sign will come false negative.
Yes.
Okay. Okay. So aortic associated aortic stenosis, LV dysfunction setting in. Okay, acute AR, yes, theoretically it is one of the discrepancies, but the peripheral signs will not be there as far as your patient here is concerned.
Yes.
Okay, the other thing, what is the other third thing which will come?
AR with coaptation of aorta.
That's right, very good, excellent. Aortic regurgitation with coaptation of aorta, where there is a wide pulse pressure in the upper extremity, but the lower extremity pulse pressure will not be fulfilling all the criteria. Okay?
Yes.
All right?
Yes, sir.
So you got it, the discrepancy between the upper extremity pulsation and the lower extremity pulsation not fulfilling the criteria of Hill sign in this patient.
Yes.
Okay?
I got it.
Now, we come to the diagnosis little later on. Okay?
Okay.
Go on.
Shall I move ahead, sir?
Okay. Yeah, please.
With regards to JVP, the mean column is not raised. There is normal waveforms with normal respiratory variation. Abdominal jugular reflex is negative. Examination of the precordium.
What about the waves? What are the waves in the JVP? Did you mention anything?
There are A waves and B waves are there, sir. They are matlab they are of normal. They are normal and they are varying normally with respiration, sir. They are, none of them is like prominent. And mean column is not.
So JVP is normal and A and the V waves are perceivable. You can say that.
Yes.
Perceivable. Okay. Yes. Yeah. All right. Okay. Go ahead.
Examination of the precordium revealed the chest to be symmetrical. There was pectus excavatum
present. Wait. Yes. Hello, Murtaja. Yes, wait, sir. Wait. Don't run away. We are still at JVP. We are still at the. Yes. You're in your case. The JVP is not showing signs of any congestion or right ventricular. Yeah. Okay. Right ventricular congestive cardiac. Now you have a patient who has got a signs of peripheral runoff. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. You're talking in terms of aortic regurgitation or other features. Now, what are the features where there is a runoff, but there is a reflection of that on the JVP?
First of all, like, sir, if there is something opening into the right chamber of the heart, like RA or RV, like ruptured sinus of Valsalva opening into the right
first
heart.
No, ruptured sinus of Valsalva. Ruptured sinus of Valsalva, where you will get the peripheral signs of runoff. And you will get a JVP which is raised, wherein you might get an A wave as well as a V wave significantly high if you have the rupture into the right side. Correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. That is one situation. What is the other situation of valvular heart disease, aortic valvular heart disease, where you will get prominence in the jugular venous pressure, and what is that?
Sir, if there is like AR, acute AR, which is leading to left ventricular failure, which in turn has led to right heart failure, producing secondary right heart failure to...
No. Don't stretch your imagination too much. Okay? Not your acute AR, no.
Okay, sir.
Does not reflect itself with the JVP. Which are valvular heart disease. Aortic valvular heart disease... Or giving you a hint, left ventricular outflow,
Burnham
obstruction.
Prominent AV.
So tell us, these things of patient who has got subvalvar hypertrophic cardiomyopathy can present with prominent AVs or whatever reason, maybe Burnham's effect or the LPA wave is very prominent. Then the other entity, some you must remember. In patients who have got isolated aortic stenosis. Isolated aortic stenosis usually do not have significant A waves in the JVP. All the incidence as far as the adult AS is concerned, aortic stenosis, okay? As far as adult aortic stenosis is concerned, almost one-fifth of them may manifest with pulmonary hypertension. In aortic stenosis, isolated aortic stenosis. The reasoning here is not known very well, but it is documented that these patients of aortic stenosis can present with pulmonary hypertension with AVA prominent in the jugular venous pressure. I'm not talking about this patient. I'm just talking in general. AVA coming up in a patient or a JVP is raised in a patient who has got valvular heart disease, aortic valvular heart disease or LV outflow obstructions. Okay. So we talked about two situations, basically RSOV, and hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. And very rarely in patients who have got isolated severe aortic stenosis.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Aortic stenosis. Go ahead.
Examination of the precordium. The chest is normal, the chest is symmetrical. Pectus excavatum is present, sir. All quadrants are moving well with respiration. Apex is present in the left sixth intercostal space, 2 centimeters lateral to the mid-clavicular line. Hyperdynamics.
Apex beat is in the?
Apex in the sixth intercostal space, sir. Left sixth intercostal space, 2 centimeters lateral to mid-clavicular line. Hyperdynamic with medial retraction, suggestive of LV type of apex.
Okay.
There is a continuous thrill. there is a continuous thrill present in the left third and fourth intercostal space. There are no parasternal or epigastric pulses.
Third? I'm not able to hear you properly, Murtaja.
Sir, there is a continuous thrill which is present in the left third and fourth intercostal space, sir.
Okay.
Left third and fourth intercostal spaces, parasternal region.
Yeah, very good. Parasternal. Okay. Yeah. Then?
There are no parasternal pulsations or epigastric pulsations.
Okay.
Suprasternal pulsations are prominently seen and felt, sir. Carotid pulsations are present. And carotid pulsations.
What do you mean carotid pulsations are present?
Suprasternal pulsations are present, basically. Yes.
Yeah. What about thrill in the suprasternal region or into the carotids? Important or not?
Sir, yes, sir, they are important. But they are not there, sir.
Yeah. So you say that it is a negative point. Important negative point.
Yes.
Okay. All right.
On percussion, the left heart border corresponds to the apex. The right heart border is retroesternal. Liver dullness is present in the right hypochondrium, and stomach tympani is in the left side. Left second intercostal space is resonant.
Intercostal space is resonant.
Resonant, yes, sir.
Oh, okay.
Moving on to the auscultation, the first heart sound is normal. The second heart sound is normal in intensity with normal.
Okay, wait for the auscultatory findings. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Wait for the auscultatory findings. Now, you know that the patient has got abnormalities of the chest wall. Correct?
Yes.
The patient has got a pectus excavate.
Yes.
Correct or not? Okay?
Yes, sir.
Now, if the patient has got pectus excavatum, how reliable is your apex beat finding? Is it reliable or is it not reliable?
It won't be that much reliable because the pectus excavatum is there. It won't be that much reliable, sir.
Okay. Now, you come to pectus excavatum.
Yes,
what do you mean by pectus excavatum?
Sir, in this case, the sternum will be deeply seated inside, and there will be like something like depression in the area of the sternum, sir. It will be like excavated.
Okay, very good. It is like the chest wall is compressed from anteroposterior, correct?
Yes.
As far as the sternal area is concerned, right? And then it bulges out. So most of the times, the heart is pushed onto the other side. One second, I got a call from Dr. Mohan Joshi.
Excavatum.
pectus excavatum. Now, most of the time, because of the abnormality of the sternum and the spine, usually the cardiac structures are pushed to the left side, most of the time, okay?
Yes.
If they are behind the sternum, still remain, that gives rise to some other issues, okay? Now, if you have a patient who has got pectus excavatum, okay?
Yes,
how will you make a diagnosis that the patient has got pectus excavatum? What is the closest finding related to pectus excavatum?
So, like clinically, we will have to see, like, if we put a ruler, sir, in the anterior chest, there will be a depression in the middle part, like at the manubrium, at the sternomandibular junction.
From the chest point, wall, if you put the ruler, then you will get a depression, sir, in between. How much is the depression which is supposed to be suggestive or diagnostic of a
excavator? Sir, in adults it is more than 3 centimeters.
3 centimeters, that is huge. That is huge. 3 centimeters is huge. Okay?
Too much.
Anything?
Yes.
Okay, I will not ask you. Anything more than 2 centimeters, if you find that the depth is more than 2 centimeters, it is highly suggestive of a pectus excavatum. Okay?
Okay.
All right?
Yes, sir.
Anything else you want to see as the diagnostic of pectus excavatum? Something.
The lateral chest.
Yes, very good. What is that? See, the differentiation as far as the X-ray diagnosis is concerned is very close to what is called as the SBS. Okay? You know what is SBS? The straight back syndrome.
Okay, sir.
You know straight back syndrome, no? Does anybody know about straight back syndrome or not? I don't hear anything from anybody.
Yes, sir.
Loss of lumbar lordosis, sir.
Yes.
Loss of the lordosis.
Basically, it is because of the loss of the lumbar lordosis, and that is why you get what is called as a straight back syndrome. Okay. Now, the straight back syndrome clinical features can be very, very closely mimicked by the pectus excavatum as far as the cardiac thing is concerned. Okay? All right? Now, if you talk about the straight back syndrome, first thing is, what is the cardiac feature which you get with a straight back syndrome? You are slightly deviating from your case.
Mitral valve collapse.
First is mitral valve collapse.
Yeah.
Why do you say that?
Yeah.
Mitral valve collapse. No. Straight back syndrome, the feature which is suggestive first thing in a normal heart is that you will get a very, very prominent, sometimes associated with thrill, is a murmur of right ventricular outflow tract ejection. Okay? The features are suggestive of pulmonary ejection murmur. Okay? In a straight back syndrome, the most prominent feature in a patient who has got straight back syndrome is an ejection systolic murmur in the pulmonary area. Now, if you want to know whether this is an organic or whether it is not an organic, you ask the patient to take a deep breath and hold it. The murmur usually softens or disappears. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Now, in patients who have got straight back syndrome, there is a high association of mitral valve prolapse. True. But mitral valve prolapse may be an incidental finding, but the incidence here is definitely much more. The prominent feature which you get is an ejection systolic murmur in the pulmonary area, which may sometimes be associated with thrill depending upon the severity of the straight back syndrome. Okay? Now, if you are going to diagnose a straight back syndrome, how are you going to diagnose the straight back syndrome? Confirmatory. Again, X-ray chest. PA and lateral.
Lateral.
PA and lateral, correct?
Yes, sir.
Now, what is the ratio diagnostic of a straight back syndrome? Hey, come on, this you must know, huh? these you must know. So two things on these skeletal things I'm going to ask you next time. One is your metacarpal index. Yes. And second is the ratio for straight back syndrome.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Write it down. Somebody has to tell me. Who's going to tell me? Murtaza?
Right. Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. Okay. So go ahead now. We are talking about now your in your findings of clinical examination. You are talking about a pulse apex beat, which is in the sixth left intercostal space, hyperdynamic, going down and out in the presence of a pectus excavating. This tells you that there possibly is a cardiomegaly, and particularly so because of the hyperdynamic circulation which you are finding with the apex beat. Yeah?
Yes.
Okay?
Yes, sir.
All right. So now go on to your examination auscultation is. Okay, fine.
Okay. On auscultation, the first heart sound is normal. The second heart sound is normal in intensity with normal split. The third and the fourth heart sounds are not present. No added sounds. There is a single murmur, sir. There is a continuous murmur heard in the left third and fourth parasternal area, which is of mixed frequency, harsh in nature, with intensity of grade 5 by 6. It's very loud, without any conduction or peaking around S2. And since it is very high in intensity, there is no change in the intensity of murmur with any of the maneuvers or respiration or limb elevation. And there is the intensity of the murmur is not peaking around S2, sir. So there is a continuous murmur which is heard in the left third and fourth parasternal region. It is of mixed frequency, harsh in intensity, which is very loud, of intensity 5 by 6, sir.
Okay.
And it is mainly confined to this area.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Anything else?
It is not peaking around S2, sir.
Yeah.
And there are no eddy sounds heard.
Okay. Anything else?
And since it is, sir, very loud, it doesn't change in intensity with any of the maneuvers or respiration.
It is 5 by 6
intensity.
Okay. Yeah, if it is 5 by 6 associated with a thrill, it's going to be a very loud murmur. And and whenever you see a loud murmur, a continuous murmur, you have to talk about negative feature of hearing over the side of the chest and the back of the chest. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Yes. In any kind, why do you say that it is a continuous murmur and this is not a to and fro murmur?
First, for a continuous murmur, sir, like as we define continuous murmur, it is a murmur which starts in systole and it overrides the S2 and it ends in diastole. So S2 is overrided in this murmur. It is a part of this murmur. Whereas in the case of to and fro murmur, the S2 is heard distinctly, sir. There will be a systolic component and there will be a diastolic component with distinct S2. And there will be a gap between the S2 and the starting of that diastolic murmur, sir.
Absolutely right. Very nice. Now you tell me, what are the conditions in which you get a to and fro murmur, like what you are getting throughout the systole as well as throughout the diastole?
Yes, sir. The differentials of to and fro murmur, first of all, is, sir, VSD with AR, sir. Second, TOF with absent pulmonary wall, AS with AR.
What? TOF with?
Absent pulmonary wall, sir.
TOF with absent pulmonary wall, you don't get a pan-systolic murmur.
Sir, to and fro murmur, we...
I'm talking about a pan-systolic and a pan-diastolic murmur.
Okay, sir. MS with MR, sir.
No? Where is the pan-diastolic murmur?
VSD with AR, sir. VSD with AR will be a to and fro. Pan-systolic murmur with the early diastolic murmur. VSD with AR.
Yeah. And what? Which other valvular heart disease?
TS with TR will have, sir.
What about TS? Why aren't you talking about mitral regurgitation with aortic regurgitation? MR with AR.
MR, AR. Yes, sir.
Correct or not, you will get the murmur of pan-systolic murmur of MR and a pan-diastolic murmur depending upon the severity of aortic regurgitation. Isn't it?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Now the feature you are talking about of a murmur, which is when you talk about a continuous murmur, let me know what are the causes of continuous murmur in the second, left and fourth, in third and fourth intercostal space.
Okay, sir. Yeah. First of all, yeah, in this like second, third,
they first talk about the talk about the continuous murmur which are heard in the second, third and fourth intercostal space. Continuous.
So the, yes, sir. First will be ruptured sinus of Valsalva, which has ruptured into the right sided cavities, RA or RV. And second, coronary cameral fistula rupturing into the right heart, sir.
Coronary cameral fistula does not, does it rupture into the right heart?
Opening into the right ventricle.
Does it rupture into the right atrium? What is the coronary AV fistulas? What is the anatomical connections there?
So the coronary artery will be forming like it will be forming a fistulous tract, sir, and it will be
with what?
Opening into a,
with what does it form the fistulous opening?
Venous chambers.
What venous chambers? Before the venous chamber, what is there? There coronary are two sinus. Features, no? Yes. There are two sinus. Features of a coronary cameral fistula. Either it opens into the right side, okay, directly, or it can open into the vein, the coronary veins. Okay?
Yes, sir.
And the most commonest place where it can occur is the large cardiac vein or the coronary sinus. That is the feature of a coronary cameral fistula. Now, most of the time, the coronary cameral fistula occurs with the which coronary artery? Incidence-wise.
RCA is the most common.
That's right. It is the right coronary artery, and usually it tends to open into the right chamber. And when it opens into the right chamber, it usually opens into the right ventricle more commonly than the right atrium. Okay? The coronary cameral fistula. Okay? Now, as far as the rupture sinus of Valsalva and the coronary, any other differential diagnosis of a continuous murmur? Heard lower down.
AP window.
No, AP window does not come lower down. No, AP window. By and large, AP window, you don't get a continuous murmur because usually is a large defect, and most of the time it's a systolic murmur or no murmur at all, presenting as a Eisenmengerized situation very early in life. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Ductus also does not come into the ear because the murmur is lower down. It's a continuous murmur associated with heady sounds.
VSDAR?
It's VSDAR, yes. Sometimes it is extremely difficult to differentiate. Extremely difficult to differentiate between a VSD with a severe aortic regurgitation, particularly if you have a prolapse of the aortic cusp. And if it is prolapse of the aortic cusp, which is the cusp which usually prolapses?
RCC, sir. Right coronary cusp is the most common.
That's right. It is the right coronary cusp which prolapses into the VSD. And in such situation, it may be very difficult to differentiate truly between the continuous murmur or whether it is a to and fro murmur. Okay?
Yes.
Now, you spoke that whenever you get a continuous murmur, by and large, it engulfs the second heart sound. In which situation, the identity and the features of the second heart sound are very, very difficult to make out. Okay?
Yes, sir.
So when you talk about the second heart sound, you say that the second heart sound is audible and the second heart sound appears to be splitting normally. You understand what I'm trying to say?
I got it.
Okay. So you are not committing onto it. You are trying to tell the examiner that you are hearing the second heart sound, but you are not sure. Okay?
Yes.
Because in most of the time, whenever you have a continuous murmur, it engulfs the second heart sound and it becomes difficult to find out what are the actual features of the second heart sound. All right, that is one thing. Now, as far as continuous murmur is concerned, you tell me, as far as the differential diagnosis is concerned of a continuous murmur, which are the continuous murmur which peak in systole and which are the continuous murmur which peak in diastole?
Yes, sir. The continuous murmur which peaks classically in systole is the PDA murmur, sir, which is said to peak in systole. And
yeah, that's right. The murmur of PDA usually tends to peak a little later in the part of the systole, engulfs the second heart sound, and then goes on to diastole. Okay, very good. Then the second one?
Which are the murmurs in peaks in diastole?
Sorry?
RSOV murmur peaks in diastole. RSOV murmur.
Yes, I'm talking about first come to systolic accentuations. Any other?
Restrictive AP window.
By and large, AP window usually has to be a very small AP window. Then yes, it accentuates during systole. It is very, all the features are suggestive of an AP window is very close to a ductus. And you can get AP window or a ductus, but ductus is an accepted diagnosis where the murmur accentuate PDA murmur, I mean the continuous murmur accentuate in systole. Okay, tell me another thing. What happens to a murmur which is of a pulmonary AV fistula?
Pulmonary AV fistula murmur will have peaking in systole.
Sure?
Not sure, sir.
If at all it peaks in systole, why does it peak in systole? Tell me what happens to the murmur of, you tend to get continuous murmur in AV fistula, you agree or not?
Yes, sir.
Yeah?
Yes, sir.
Particularly in large AV fistulas, you get a continuous murmur. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay? Now, ideally speaking, the continuous murmur, because of the pulmonary AV fistula, it should peak usually in systole. Okay? Because of the hemodynamics. But because it is occurring little later in the part of the systolic ejection of the blood coming to the pulmonary AV fistula site, okay, there is a time gap between the ejection and the time the murmur is generated. Okay, so that is why ideally speaking the murmur should have peaked in systole, but it does not peak in systole, it usually peaks in diastole. Okay,
yes, sir.
You understood?
Okay.
You understood because of the time gap between the ejection from the right ventricle coming to the periphery. So these are the murmurs usually supposed to be peaking in systole because it is a right-sided event, but it does not. It goes little later in diastole. Now coming to which are the murmurs which peak in diastole?
Sir, first of all, RSOV rupturing into the right heart, either into RA or RV.
Then yes,
coronary cameral fistula.
Yes. Because basically it's a diastolic event in the coronary AV fistula. And here the gradient in the right sinus of Valsalva, I mean the sinus, rupture sinus of Valsalva, it is usually the gradient is maximum during diastole. Okay? So it's the murmur which are accentuated basically in diastole. Yeah? Okay?
Yes. Even venous hum will be more prominent in diastole.
Very good. Excellent. This is venous hum sometimes can be heard, but the location of a venous hum is totally
much higher. This year,
much higher into the, it is usually infraclavicular lesion close to the sternoclavicular joint, a murmur of hum. But that is also a diagnosis which comes into continuous murmur. Okay. All right. So you have features of severe leak from the aorta going on to the right side with a thrill and a continuous murmur grade 5-6 in the left parasternal region lower down. Okay, all right.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So what is your diagnosis or differential diagnosis? You want to give diagnosis, you want to give differential diagnosis.
Sir, I would like to put, it is very obvious from the examination findings, sir. Even before auscultation, it was very obvious. I would put a diagnosis statewide, sir, as it to be a situs solitus, levocardia, aortic congenital heart disease, with left to right shunt, post-tricuspid shunt, acute ruptured sinus of Valsalva into the right ventricular cavity.
When you are giving the diagnosis, you say that it is a situs solitus.
Yes, sir.
Okay. First thing, it's a situs solitus levocardia situation. Okay.
Yes.
You talk about the feature. Don't talk about first as the left to right shunt.
Okay.
You have to first talk about what is the causative feature of the patient first. Okay. Of the diagnosis. So you say that there is a rupture sinus of Valsalva as the first diagnosis there. And then you say that there is a shunt occurring because coming from the aorta to this thing. Don't give first diagnosis as the shunt.
Got it, sir. Got it.
You understand what I'm
saying?
Your sequence has to be different. You don't emphasize first on the shunt and then you say that it is a rupture sinus of Valsalva.
Yes. First I have to give the lesion and then the amount.
That's right. Yes. You give the lesion first as the causative feature first and then you talk about the other things. Okay. So talk about rupture sinus of Valsalva into the
right ventricular cavity most probably.
Why do you say so confidently that it is only into the right
sir, because ventricle. First of all, I am getting the features in the left parasternum, sir. And
you said there is no parasternal. If there is no parasternal,
I am getting
nothing.
Thrill continuously in the third and fourth intercostal spaces. That is the.
That can occur even if it is ruptures into the right atrium.
In right atrium, we may also get on the right side of parasternum, sir. Features. So.
Not necessarily. No.
So.
It is usually limited to the left side of the parasternal region. What is one feature which tells you that this is not coming into the right atrium?
Sir, the JVP.
Think of other things which are coming. No, I told you in the beginning, rupture sinus of Valsalva, if it is coming into the right side, into the RA, basically you will get the JVP which is raised.
Yes.
You will get the A wave which is little more prominent, which is not in your case. So you are definitely telling that it is coming directly into the right ventricle. The right ventricle is still not failing. Correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So it's a rupture of sinus of Valsalva coming into the right ventricle and
coming into the right with hemodynamically significant shunt amount, sir. Most probably more than 1.5:1.
Mm-hmm.
In sinus rhythm.
Yeah.
No pH.
Yeah.
Presently in NYHA class 2 with NYHA class 2 on medications without any signs of infective endocarditis and no pH, sir.
Then forget about infective endocarditis. What about the other signs? Any signs of congestive cardiac failure? Hello?
Yes, sir.
This is a shunt which is occurring from the left to the right.
Yes, sir.
And burden is coming on to the right side. So you have to make a mention whether the patient is having signs of congestive cardiac failure also or not.
The JVP is
so
not.
There is an important point, a positive or a negative point when the diagnosis is coming. So that I know that this patient has got a rupture sinus of Valsalva, but is presently hemodynamically quite stable. Isn't it?
I got it. Yes, sir.
Yeah? Okay.
Yes.
Now, coming to the thing, as far as your history is concerned, his onset started with palpitation and it started aggravating over the last 2 months. Okay?
Yes, sir.
So, how do you explain those things on the basis of your history and the basis of your diagnosis? We are almost coming to a pinpoint diagnosis that this is rupture sinus of Valsalva into the right heart. Correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, usually when it comes into the right heart, you tend to have a little bit of a parasternal heave, which again may be obliterated. You can come out of it saying that the patient has got a
pectus.
That's pectus excavatum. you would have expected this patient to have some signs of parasternal activity which is reflecting the right-sided events, but you are not because of the pectus. And you can say you can easily get out of it. Okay.
Yes, sir. Okay, sir.
All right. Okay. So what did I ask you? The question?
Sir, that the symptoms since last 2 years, but he has been symptomatic mainly in the last 2 months. So, sir, can we put it like, I would like to put it like, it was a, initially it was a rupture which was very small in amount of RSOV, and it has suddenly the rupture amount has increased in the last 2 months, and so he has presented with features of heart failure. Maybe it was a hemodynamically insignificant shunt initially, which was very small, but in the time duration of 2 years, it suddenly has, the amount of shunt has increased because of acute rupture maybe.
What acute rupture? The rupture has already occurred.
It was like very small initially, sir, but now the amount has increased.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. Anybody else wants to give an explanation for this, that the patient is having started with very minimal symptoms and then has aggravated over the course of time?
Previous VST, sir.
So.
Previous VSD was there, sir. So there may be coaptation failure which is causing AR initially. So
don't. Who's this? What is your name?
This is Dr. Chetan, sir.
Chetan. Don't make statements which will land you up in trouble for talking about VSD with coaptation and things like that. Okay? Don't talk about things. Now, we have come to a diagnosis which is suggestive and which is pinpointing definitely towards rupture sinus of Valsalva into the right side. We are talking about what is happening, why does it that the patient had a rupture sinus. By and large, you must remember that rupture sinus of Valsalva is an acute or a semi-acute situation.
Yes, sir.
Correct or not?
Yes, sir.
Most of the time it is like that. Here is a patient who has had a rupture sinus, the features of complaint starting about 2 years back. And then since the last 2 months, it has deteriorated.
Yes, sir.
Correct?
Yes, sir.
So I'm asking you an explanation. You gave an explanation stating that there is an acute rupture. What is acute rupture? He has already had a rupture of Valsalva.
Maybe patient was having a VSD which was causing the cusp prolapse, which was causing AR. So initially he was having palpitations. Over a period of time, the cusp has prolapsed so much and now RSOV has developed 2 months back. So because of that, acute heart failure has developed.
Very good. Excellent. See, you must remember, what is the etiopathology of rupture sinus of Valsalva? First is, Murtaza, you tell me, which are the sinuses? You know that the right sinus of Valsalva,
it is the
right
most sinus,
is divided into three parts, correct?
Yes, sir.
The anterior one-third, the middle one-third, and the posterior one-third, correct?
Yes, sir.
Correct or not?
Yes,
of the right sinus of Valsalva. Okay. As far as the anatomical connections which come closest to it are what? So, for example, there are three positions in which the rupture sinus of Valsalva can go. One is into the RA, the other is into the RV, and very rarely into the
PA also.
What?
It goes into PA or... other chamber, left heart also, sir, LV.
This does not go into the LV, it goes into the left atrium.
Okay.
That is on the basis of the features of the proximity of the sinus of Valsalva sinuses. Now, the sinus has got three scallops, right sinus, which is divided into three parts. Okay. Now, you tell me which one is likely to go into which part.
Sir, in the right sinus, the left portion of it will go most probably towards the pulmonary valve, sir. Whereas the mid portion of it will go towards the right ventricle.
the most anterior portion of the one third usually tends to rupture into the right ventricular outflow tract.
Yes, okay? Yes, sir.
The middle one third goes closest to the body of the right ventricle.
Yes, sir.
The posterior part goes to the right atrium by and large. Okay?
Yes.
It is only the non-coronary cusp rupture which might go into the left atrium. Non-coronary cusp, left atrium. Okay?
Okay.
Very close to it. Alright?
Yes,
so these are usually the anatomic features of rupture where it is going to occur as far as the right cusp is concerned. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Now, most of the time, the rupture of sinus of Valsalva is associated with what?
It is associated with, like, AR is a common feature, sir, in those cases because of the prolapse which of the
right. It is basically because of lack of support to the sinus as far as the aortic right cusp is concerned. Okay? Now, many a times, the cusp support is lacking because of a underlying small VSD which might be there to begin with.
Yes.
Okay? Now, most of the time, initially, the VSD gets closed with the prolapse of the cusp and ultimately the cusp prolapses so much that it starts giving rise to aortic regurgitation into the right side. You understood what I'm trying to say?
Yes, sir.
That the prolapse goes on increasing over the course of time. So this is a sign that this patient has got a rupture sinus of Valsalva, which is not a very acute situation going in to a sudden increase in the symptomatology. Now, whenever you get a sudden increase in this symptomatology, there are two causes which can give rise to this particular entity. First is if you have aortic infective endocarditis occurring in a already prolapsing aortic cusp, and the second is post-traumatic.
Post-traumatic, yeah.
Okay.
Okay, sir.
These are the two features where there is going to be an acute presentation of rupture sinus of Valsalva occurring into the right side. You got it?
Yes, sir.
The second is the natural history of rupture of sinus of Valsalva with somebody said that it is because of VSD. The initial phase, there was only a prolapse. It was only a regurgitation which was occurring. Now the prolapse has increased significantly and then giving rise to a direct right to left shunt occurring. I mean left to right shunt occurring with a rupture sinus of Valsalva. Okay?
Yes, sir.
You understand?
Yes,
so
sir.
This is likely to be the situation, but it does not warrant that it could be a rupture sinus of Valsalva which was initially supposed to be very small. And over the course of time, it has progressed significantly, okay? But our clinical diagnosis is more likely that if you present acutely, it is either going to be a post-traumatic or it is going to be a infective endocarditis situations in these patients, okay?
Yes.
All right?
Yes, sir.
All right. Okay. Okay. Very good. Very good. So, what about the ECG or
yes,
X-ray?
Sir. I'll just share the screen, sir. I have.
Thank you. Yeah.
Sir, ECG, sir.
Mm-hmm.
Sir, this is a four-channel 12-lead ECG of the patient with normal standardization of the limb leads and chest leads with a speed of 25 mm per second. With sinus rhythm, the heart rate is approximately 100 beats per minute.
Yeah.
The QRS axis is normal. The axis is approximately plus 30 degrees.
Yeah.
With the counterclockwise looping, Q waves are present in lead 1 and AVL, sir. Normal in lead 1 and
one in AVL. Yeah, I can see that AVL. Yeah.
So counterclockwise looping is there, sir.
Yeah.
There is the P wave.
Normal or abnormal?
That is normal, sir.
That's right. Okay.
The P wave axis is normal with normal morphology. There is no. There is no right atrial or left atrial enlargement.
There is no atrial enlargement.
Okay. No atrial enlargement.
Yeah.
The PR interval is 120 milliseconds, which is normal, sir. moving on to the pericardial leads, there is feature, there are by different voltage criteria.
Tell me the diagnosis, Dukko, because I have to leave by in another 5 minutes time. Yeah. Yes. What are the features, classical features here pointing to you?
LVH, sir, LVH is present, sir.
By the voltage criteria.
Cornell's voltage and Sokolov line, sir, both of those.
Yeah. The voltage criteria. If they ask you, then you go into the detail. Okay?
Yes.
Voltage criteria.
Yes.
What other thing which you are finding here? That this is left ventricular hypertrophy with a normal axis and what else?
Volume overloaded pattern.
That's right. Volume overloaded pattern. You must say that because the T wave is upright here.
Yes,
although you are not getting a Q wave, significant Q wave in the left sided leads, looks like they are, even V6 also you are not getting it. I lost the ECG.
Yeah, sorry sir, sorry. It is like somewhere stuck here.
Okay, that's okay. So you are postulating that this is a volume overloaded left ventricle, correct? There are no features suggesting here that there is a right sided overload, correct?
Yes, sir.
Neither there is a volume overloaded right ventricle or there is no axis which is suggesting that there is a right ventricular strain.
Yes, sir.
Correct or not?
Yes,
where are you with the diagnosis? Your diagnosis is still consistent or it is not consistent?
It is consistent, but it is consistent, sir, but we should get some features suggestive of right ventricular enlargement also. But we are not getting.
Now here again, you have to be a smart enough fellow. You say that you would have expected, because there is a biventricular event occurring in my patient, I would have expected that the axis would be more to rightwards.
Okay.
But it is predominantly a left ventricular hypertrophy, so I am not too sure about the right ventricle. The second thing you have to take into consideration that this patient has got a pectus.
Yes.
You understand pectus?
I got it. Yes, sir.
And that is why I may be missing out the biventricular situation of the right ventricular potentials here. Okay? Whether it is occurring or not, we are not sure. But this is the way you are likely to get out of this situation. Okay? Wherein you are expecting some right ventricular dominance also here. Okay?
Yeah.
All right?
Yes.
So you can say that this is there, but the thing is that I am not getting the axis deviation suggestive, neither I am getting any right ventricular potential. But I am taking this with a pinch of salt because of the pectus. All right?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Move on.
This is the chest X-ray, sir. PA view of the patient. It is well centralized and well exposed, well penetrated.
Yeah.
Situs is solitus. Cardiomegaly is present, sir, with a CT ratio of 0.55.
Yeah.
And LV type of apex is present, sir.
Yeah, it is suggestive of LV type. Don't say LV type of an apex in a PA view. Okay?
Yeah.
You always make modulations in your statements. Okay? That this is suggestive of a left ventricular type. All right? Okay. If I want to be certain, I would like to take the lateral view and make a confirmation. All right?
Okay, sir.
Okay.
Right atrium is dilated in this X-ray. Three intercostal spaces are on the right side are present, sir, in this case.
Yes.
Section of right atrium is there.
Yeah. Above that, what is that shadow?
Main pulmonary artery is dilated, sir.
Forget about main
right descending.
I'm talking about the right side.
Right descending pulmonary.
Right silhouette. Right silhouette.
Yeah.
You have one below that. Come down below. Yeah. What is that? And below that there is something overlapping each other. Correct? This is what? What? And beyond that is something else.
This is shadow.
Right?
I don't know.
Sorry?
Sir, this you are asking. This one. Sir.
Yes.
And this is left atrial shadow. Shadow and shadow. This is right
atrium. The other part of the left atrium. Why do you say it is left atrium only? Below that is the right atrium. There is a shadow between the right atrium and the superior vena cava, correct?
This area, sir.
Everybody agree to it or not?
Ascending aorta.
Correct. If the ascending aorta is going to be dilated significantly, I am seeing some clinical approach.
Okay, sir. Yes, sir. Here, sir, this area.
So yeah, you are seeing something in between the SVC and the right atrium. The right atrium is prominent, definitely, but there is something in between. It is not the left atrium because you are not seeing the other features of double atrium shadow. Seeing the straightening of the left heart border. You are not seeing any venous conditions. Yeah. This is likely to be the ascending aorta, which is common, prominent. These are scenes when the aorta is volume overload. This can be seen in severe aortic regurgitation. Okay? It can be seen in severe aortic stenosis where there is a post-stenotic dilatation. Okay? It can be seen with rupture sinus of Valsalva. Or it can be seen in coarctation of aorta or aortic aneurysm where the right side of the heart is also made up by the part of the aorta. Got it?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So still it is consistent with your diagnosis that this could be a dilated ascending aorta. The pulmonary vasculature is increased. The RPA is large. Now, can you tell me, Murtaja,
what are
the diagnostic features of pulmonary hypertension on plain X-ray chest?
It is too much.
I'll ask you the question next time. Finish off this.
Pulmonary venous.
Because I have to go.
Okay, sir. So, for pulmonary venous hypertension, sir, we have
different stages. I'm not talking about pulmonary venous hypertension. We'll discuss sometime later.
In the case of
go.
Chest X-ray pulmonary arterial hypertension, there won't be, sir. Cardiomegaly won't be there. It would have regressed. If it is a forced tricuspid, the MPA will be dilated, sir. The pulmonary.
No. I'm asking you. Okay, quickly tell me the basis of diagnosis. Cardiac heart size is nothing into consideration.
Sir, the main pulmonary artery will be dilated, sir.
How much dilated? On the basis of dilatation of the, pulmonary artery, main pulmonary artery, on the basis of the right arterial, arterial diameter.
Right descending artery diameter, sir, for males and females, we have different values, sir. For males, it is more than 17 and for females, more than 16. Right descending pulmonary artery, then it is said to be dilated, sir.
Dilated. I am talking about pulmonary hypertension correlation between the pulmonary artery size, main pulmonary artery size, and the right pulmonary artery.
Okay.
Does anybody know?
Yes, sir. If the ratio of the main pulmonary artery upon right pulmonary artery is more than 1.5, it is said to be dilated.
Very good. No, not dilated. It is pulmonary hypertension situation.
Pulmonary hypertension, yes.
Okay. Yeah, ratio of main pulmonary artery to the right, absolute values of main pulmonary artery at the right ventricle, right pulmonary artery. Anybody?
The 5 millimeter.
This is given in Hurst. At least
25
millimeter. We read. Don't give some answers like that. So find out this.
Okay, sir.
Okay. So yes. Pulmonary arterial hypertension size of MPA and right pulmonary artery. Okay.
Yes.
The other thing I asked you is metacarpal index. And the third one which I asked you what?
Sir, you asked. Sir, straight back syndrome, sir, you asked.
SBS, yes. How you make a diagnosis of SBS. So, yes. Three things I have told you.
There was a rupture sinus of Valsalva, sir, from the right sinus of opening into the RV cavity, sir, with mild TR was there with RVSP of 40. And right ventricular systolic pressure of 40, sir.
Yes,
sir.
Which we expected because there is no signs of right ventricular dysfunction here, neither there is TR. Okay, yes. A wave is not prominent, so it is going to be confined to the right ventricle. Okay,
yes, sir.
P2 component. Now, the other feature which I wanted to tell you is that you spoke about resonance in the second left intercostal space. Okay,
yes, sir.
Now, this thing you have to be very, very careful when you make an identity as far as your final diagnosis is concerned. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Now you have to be very smart enough when you make this. When you tell me that there is resonance in the second left intercostal space, the first thing which goes to my mind is there is no pulmonary hypertension or the pulmonary artery is very small.
Yes, sir.
You understand?
Yes, sir.
So, when you correlate your findings, physical findings, you correlate little bit with your final diagnosis. That's what I wanted to tell you. Okay, because I kept it in mind that you said that the second left intercostal space is resonant. Okay, which I will never expect in this particular patient. Okay, particularly when the patient has got pectus excavated.
Okay, sir. Yes, I got
you. You understand?
So you
have to be smart enough to modulate whatever your findings are in a patient, particular patient. Okay, all right.
Yes, sir. Got it.
Okay,
yes, sir.
I think so. Good, very good presentation.